recreational tourism at War Mineral Springs, possibly degrading the heritage archaeology of that site, if at all?
The wellness, War Mineral Springs was developed, even prior to its development, it was used as a wellness, as a place where people came to experience a therapeutic water and heal from. That's a very important heritage component, is its traditional cultural use. And I see that as is important sometimes as the archaeological resource right now. One thing is the archaeology, the participation in the wellness, in my opinion, hasn't additionally degraded the archaeology that's on the 40-foot ledge or on the bottom, because people don't have access to it. What degraded War Mineral Springs and put it to its present condition that should be remaining resources protected is the preparation of making it what it is today. Back in the 50s, we didn't know the level of significance of some of these sites. And in general, we didn't take our historical resources into consideration. Up until the late 1950s, Florida Department of Transportation actively mined national monument shell mounds for roadbed. That was done statewide. Farmers, people who owned shell mounds on their property, and these are landmarks. These are grand features on our landscape, were considered resources for sale, and dump truck after dump truck after dump truck came and mined these monuments for roadbed. It wasn't until 1958-59 that Ross Morrell, one of the first state archaeologists, said, "Wait a minute, I'm charged with protecting our natural resources of our state, and the Florida Department of Transportation is actively mining them for roadbed." So too with War Mineral Springs. Initially, the entire basin, all the sediment, that time capsule we talk about in the basin, who knows what was in it and who knows where it is now, was mined out and maybe filled in some low spots in the area, maybe dumped into the bottom, who knows, and then sand was put in. So we don't know, what impact that has, but I think that the community of War Mineral Springs and the people that use it in their wellness have played a very important role and should be considered for any future use of War Mineral Springs. And so I don't think the traditional historic use of War Mineral Springs should be discontinued because of the archaeology of the property. The damage to this point has been done. Now it's our job to preserve what's done and maintain what's being done.
Well, then let me ask another question. I'm going to just leave this one wide open, and whoever would like to chime in, just raise your hand. From a scientific standpoint, what would be the important considerations if one were considering additional physical development at the site of, for instance, War Mineral Springs? Long question, so I'll reframe it. What would be the considerations? In other words, what would be the things that you would really want to be careful about if you were talking about additional development at a site like War Mineral Springs?
Be very cautious.
Yeah, mine would be very cautious of where or how close you can build something to the spring. For example, I've done a lot of work in Mexico, and then I went and explored caves in Mexico, then came back a year later, and there was a piling going through the top of the cave from a building. So it's very important that we don't build. War Mineral Springs doesn't go straight down, it goes horizontal. If you build a structure, even horizontally from War Mineral Springs with X amount of feet, there's a chance of a caving. The cave is actually in the north side of the spring. Since I mapped it, I know where it is. But if you drill a 200-foot pylon on the north side of the spring, there is a chance you felt the collapse. I think that would be very important to make sure that you can't build within so far in the spring.
Uzi. Thank you for...
Yeah, no, I think what you're pointing towards is there's still more studies to be done, that we do need to understand more of the geology of the location and have a sense of where there's danger areas. We need to have a sense of those changing water qualities so that you don't have so many people go into the water that there's a presence, makes an effect. I think a lot of that information needs to be organized. But then there's also the sense of the vistas and how it looks, that even if the ground could hold a whole bunch of buildings, I don't think more mineral springs would look the same if there are high rises all around it. It's not just the collapse issue, it's also the natural beauty of the place that needs to be taken into account. For the archaeological aspects, I think there's probably a good sense of what people shouldn't be touching. And I think as Dr. Clifford has made clear, it's actually difficult to get down there. So it's not so much a way of someone just kind of walking in, swimming down, causing trouble. It's pretty deep in there. But how many people should be allowed at any one time? What kind of building should be there? I think that has to be the next set of discussions once we have all that scientific information on the landscape together.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Michelle?
There's also the issue of people were drawn to that area for a long period of time, and they probably settled not right on top of the cement bay, right around the spring, but maybe on the edges, a little bit further into the woods, around it. So I would consider that a high probability area, that if they were going to break ground, they would have to do archaeological studies first, and they probably would come across really significant sites that are tied to the spring. So while in the short term we'd be able to uncover a lot of information, in the long term we might be wrecking it. So I think that it would probably become very expensive for a company if they wanted to put a building in to do all that archaeology that would be required. So that's another perspective, is on the landscape itself that would be affected.
Thank you, Michelle. Joe?
When we think about four mineral springs in terms of extended periods of sort of constant activity, and then sort of nodes in time of intense activity. And it seems to me with the change in ownership now into public ownership and all that's going on, now we're in this sort of intense node of thinking out what to do with it. Similarly, like I mentioned before, the 1950s time period of development, those folks with their eyes, they did some things like around the edge, put some sand and planted some palm trees to sort of evoke a certain vision of what this sort of oasis kind of thing might be, but which was not consistent with the way we think of things now. But on the other hand, consistently during that period, the developers did not build big buildings right there. There was the buildings that are built we're familiar with. There was an unbuilt pavilion that Victor Lundy designed that was very modest in scale and in one particular side location, so that the view shed, sometimes we call it, or the view from that area was unimpeded by buildings. And I think that aesthetic and ethic is something that we can carry forward today, not only for the practical thing of not messing up archaeological resources that are undoubtedly surrounding the springs, but simply preserving the notion and the character of the natural environment there.
Well, that was a question that required four people to respond, so appreciate that, and maybe a fifth. So John, step right up, sir.
And there's just the basics, you know, watershed management. People will look at how do you do wastewater, how do you do water supply, how do you do stormwater. So it's not nobody mentioned this very fundamental stuff, but in any development, you would look and say, hey, are we going to run stormwater into this thing? You know, that's not the modern way, it's the old way. How are we going to do water supply? Are we going to drill wells here? Are we going to put pipelines in? What are the effects of those? Are we going to withdraw water, pump water down into the ground, like treated effluent, things like that? You know, those are pretty well understood, and in certain watersheds, a higher priority is given to them. So, for example, a drinking water supply above a reservoir, a municipal reservoir that's used for water, drinking water supply, different standards would apply. Septic systems have to be set back from drinking water wells. But
Little salt is more environmentally sensitive than more mineral. I mean, because it is still has an intact perimeter around the basin, and a lot of it's low-lying land, and the slough itself is a watery feature, a wetland, and it's bisected by Price Boulevard. And when, it was originally called McCarthy Boulevard, but it was built in 1973, it impacted the slough substantially, and it was ditched. There are drainage ditches going through along the north side of the slough and then out the northeast end, and it lowered water tables there, or the water table there, and it caused a lot of damage to the archaeological resources in the slough and changed the character of the slough. In a way, the slough could be rehydrated some, possibly, if there were some changes in drainage, in the artificial drainage that's there now. But so in 1973, the water table was lowered artificially, and there were fires after that. A lot of peat dried out, oxidized, and disappeared, and there were fires. So there was a lot of damage done to the Little Salt slough in the mid-1970s. And I'm sure Steve and Dr. Gifford can tell us a lot more about the Midden slough and then the surrounding area actually within the Little University of Miami property.
Thousands of visitors and nearly 4,000 Sarasota County students have come to historic Spanish Point to study our history and our prehistory and the archaeology. At the Spanish Point site is a significant ancient water source. Can it be evaluated and publicized and understood in harmony with the Little Salt Spring and War Mineral Spring?
I'm not exactly sure what the person in the audience is referring to. I mean, there is a water source. I mean, I want to be sure I answer their question.
The horseshoe mound is what I'm thinking, you know, in the center of the horseshoe mound.
The ring-shaped or horseshoe-shaped shell midden, the Hill Cottage midden, covers about 6 acres. And there's an eastern arm and a western arm, and it's low-lying land in between, which is often damp after heavy rains, does hold water. I've been there, I've walked across it many times in the 1980s. And I'm not certain there's actually what one can classify as a spring, however. There's maybe some groundwater seepage, but there's no a vent, if you will. There's no actual, that I'm familiar with or have ever seen, water coming out of a deeper source between the arms of the Hill Cottage and Midden.
Historically, pre-development may very well have been natural springs. But even today, there are a number of areas where, yes, there's water flowing out of the ground. It's not what I, as a geologist, would call a spring. It is a seep. You typically shallow water in the water table, that the slope of the water table leading from the upland to the bay is intersected by a steeper cutoff of a terrace. And so people have a wet area coming. Now there's water flowing out of the ground in front of the house. That's not really a spring. It's a seep.
Connection to Ponce de Leon and the Fountain of Youth that so many of us in the country are taught in school.
Thanks, I don't know if that it's a coincidence Jody Johnson sitting there when this question comes up or not.
if before Warm Mineral Springs, the spa closed, they did advertise themselves in terms of wellness and as the Fountain of Youth, going with Ponce de Leon. That story. There's two levels to that question. One, in terms of what we know of Ponce de Leon, the Lunate to Florida back in 1513, he didn't come that far north. He didn't get this far, he got to Charlotte Harbor, but not to here. Second, Michael Francis, who's a professor, history professor over at USF St. Pete, has gone through the original material. It seems real clear to him, at least, that the story of Ponce de Leon looking for the Fountain of Youth was a sarcastic attack on him written a few decades after he died. So he may never have been looking for any such thing. You know, earlier, John always put the question of authenticity. The myth of Ponce de Leon's Fountain of Youth is a cute one. It's not bad to have cartoons about it. But the actual history is so much more interesting. And I worry that when we focus on this sort of make-believe history, we don't have the time or the energy to actually get into the larger, more important questions. As several, as Michelle said it most clearly,
We know the Native Americans used this water source and used it for thousands and thousands of years. Let's spend a little effort on those stories and try to find out what myths might have existed or legends about the springs in the Seminole tradition, rather than just reproducing what looks like a sarcastic critique of what's the real in the present day.
You handled that eloquently, sir. Here's one that's part comment, part question. Thank you, panel, for expressing the significance and research potential of both springs. Now that they will be both under public ownership, how would you see future research being managed? And I'm just going to open this up wide. And then I will pick on someone.
That's a good question.
Okay, next question.
The research management is going to be an issue, without a doubt. And what level the Northport and the county will take it for Mineral Springs, and what level the county will take it Little Salt Spring, will certainly be open to conjecture as things go forward. Personally, what I would like to see happen would be the research to be allowed to continue at Little Salt Spring only under the auspices of an educational program and center that could be facilitated through a university, since Sarasota County may not be in the research, the archaeological research business, then collaborate with someone who is in the archaeological resource research business or interest, and have them coordinate their research through that. And there are a number of potential partners, but it doesn't have to happen overnight. And there's still the plastron of a extinct tortoise on the 27-meter ledge in the 5-meter units that we opened up. It's still going to be there 10,000 years from now. But right now, it coincides with the data that we have collected from 2008 to 2011. So continued research there would be an obvious step, so baby steps. Well, Mineral Springs, there's all types of research potential at Well Mineral Springs, but it too will be there 10,000 years from now. But if you want to evaluate what is left at Well Mineral Springs, what needs to be done, and where can you test to evaluate what is left there? Video, test, non-destructive, evaluate pristine areas, and then maybe sample them. But if nothing is urgent at Well Mineral Springs, but it would be nice to get baseline data, get some funding, work in conjunction with the county. And I think there's a great potential, but always with the mind of interpretation and education for the public.
Dr. Gifford's going to grab on, and then Uzi will wrap up with you, and we'll move on.
It would make a lot of sense, as I'm sure you all realize, to look for analogous situations, and there, in fact, is a very famous one which you could go home and get on the web and take a look at it. That is the La Brea Tar Pit in Los Angeles.
Uzi.
Yeah, that's a great example, Dr. Gifford. I think part of where we're at is, and, you know, we have this Sarasota County archaeologist here, the director of the Sarasota County History Center. That there just need to have protocols in place so that people would get permits that would have very clear criteria that Steve laid out. The concern for presentation, interpretation, education should be central, any new research, as well as to have documentation. I think that just needs to be in place, and then hopefully we'll find some research institution or research team would be wanting to do and meet those criteria as the continuing research go on.
Covered on the grounds of both of the springs, you know, what's up there on the surface. And then another person commented on the population of manatees that depend upon the downstream flow from Warm Mineral Springs. So clearly there's an ecological aspect to this, in addition to the history, the heritage, the anthropology, the archaeology, the geology, the hydrology. So who would like to talk a little bit about either some of the ecological aspects on the surface? And then maybe we need to think about the next time we would do something like this, we should involve the manatee folks and some of the other folks that are involved in some of the other disciplines. So if somebody would like to take manatees or ecological fines, that would be great. And you can volunteer to do that before you are appointed.
Regarding the ecological components of Little Salt Spring, I mean, it's they're unprecedented. And I mentioned it in the article. There's a natural continuum going back from the late Pleistocene at Little Salt Spring that's never been affected by development, affected by natural causes because of the spring. So you've got five species of ground orchid. You've got a species that's never been found north of the Fakahatchee Strand in Collier County. So you've got this isolated ecosystem that's been fragmented, detached from the natural ecosystem of the surrounding. And you have this little patch that remains. And it was a remaining patch prior to development, going back to the 40s, going back to the early to mid 1900s. There was this fragmented ecosystem based on the spring. And all those conditions remained present because of that. And it hasn't changed through normal climatological regional changes. Because of the spring, it's remained the same. So ecologically, Little Salt Spring is still in that state. Of course, it went from a more hardwood hammock with hickory to a more mesic hammock with red bay and dahoon holly. There are those changes as well. But through it all, the plants and animals, the native communities that were there 12,000 years ago, many of them are still there. And you can read that in the paleontological record when you study the sediments. So ecologically, Little Salt Spring is in its pristine state. And you cannot replicate it. Once it's gone, you can't re-Disney it. You can't bring it back to life. You can't bring back to life what's been lost at Warm Mineral Spring. It's gone. You will not bring back the ecosystem of the surrounding landscape at Warm Mineral Springs. So let's treasure what's left of it and not continue on the same process. When I say the archaeology shouldn't impede what's going on, certainly on the landscape, if you develop all around it, you're going to have to take the archaeology into consideration. But in the ecosystem of Warm Mineral Springs, the water still has a tremendous value, but it's been compromised already. Don't compromise it anymore if you can. But Little Salt Spring is like it's the Jurassic Park of the Pleistocene, and that's what we need to focus on.
I think, Steve, you would make a great star in that movie. Walter, this is a question for you, a little bit of a follow-up to some things that you said earlier. Has there been any thought or discussion about combining architectural sites? In other words, such as the motel out on 41, could that become part of a museum, or could a museum or an archaeological prep site become part of that?
There's been a little bit of debate as to if we did go through with the museum project, where it would go. I think we've kind of touched on it a little bit with the last series of questions. Some people have suggested that a cyclorama would make a decent museum, it could store a little better. Some others have suggested that there's another building down the road that has been used at some point for various, what was it used for, Bill?
A wax museum.
It was a wax museum at some point. That's another option. There's plenty of property along 41 that could theoretically work. There's also, we discussed little bits here and there about the Warm Mineral Springs property itself. If there was a spot there where we could possibly develop a small museum.
I think there's still a lot more planning that would have to go in before we'd be able to bring it forward in any real way. Certainly, we'd have to consider the archaeological survey and survey for archaeological resources before we dug. We certainly would not want to get terribly close to the spring, as Curtis pointed out. But I think there's definitely a way to go about doing it, as long as we are careful and conscientious of what we're doing.
How does that speak to us? And
the if you're not familiar with red carpets, they are a natural hydrocarbon seep that is part of the general trend of oil resources in Southern California, and they were basically the city of Los Angeles grew up around the red carpets, and there have been all kinds of interesting interactions between the government of Los Angeles County and scientists concerning when and where and how to recover as much information as possible from the La Brea tar pits without covering them over with concrete.
Hydrologists, any correlation between the hot springs here in Florida and the hot springs in Yellowstone National Park?
Not really.
Okay, thank you, Bobby. And here's one that actually has been on my mind since I was in high school and college. Did the deep well injection wells that we use for disposing of sewage, how do these potentially impact these resources that we have here in Little Salt and War Mineral Springs?
A lot more relevant than the Yellowstone. Yellowstone is basically, there is a geothermal source of a actually volcanic origin out of Yellowstone. That's not the source of the hot water at War Mineral Springs. With regards to deep injection wells, I'll say that in Florida, there are very, very few hazardous waste wells, and those are pretty much out of the picture for anything we're talking about because they're in much deeper zones, far removed from the area. In this part of Florida, going basically the majority of the south half of Florida, deep injection wells are used to dispose of both treated municipal wastewater and reject concentrate from water treatment from reverse osmosis and electrodialysis reversal water purification. So we use these
salty water.
We use these wells to get rid of excess water. We prefer to put that water down in the ground in a zone that it's not going to harm the environment, as opposed to letting, for instance, excess treated wastewater flow to our bays, rivers, and streams. The injection zones, when the wells are permitted, there's a lot of study goes into proving supporting the confinement so the water doesn't migrate upwards around the injection zone. There's also studies done to look at what is the regional trend of water flow, and specifically for War Mineral Springs, when the North Port systems were put in, the engineers had to provide modeling that would show that the groundwater was not expected to flow towards the spring. And indeed, there's long-term monitoring that goes on to support that there hasn't been any impact to War Mineral Springs from any injection going on.
Archaeological sites are cultural assemblages, not natural assemblages. That is, they're not fossil reefs. They are there as a result of human agency, which has a lot of cultural bias, and intentional behavior, goal-oriented attainment of resources, etc., to create an archaeological site. So it's not a mirror of the environment. You can't go out and take a shell midden and apply it to the natural environment blindly. You'll get the wrong answer. You have to be very, very careful in what evidence you, if you do try to do that, you have to be extremely careful. So there are some people that are trying to model the environment based on remains in a shell midden. I'm very skeptical of much of that research. You have to be extremely careful what you're doing. As I say, to just reiterate, shell middens are not fossil reefs. They're a cultural assemblage of materials. And so you have to view them as through the human filter and interpreting it that way and getting to culture is what archaeologists are trying to study in the first place. For doing geology, climatology, really you have to go to the geologic record, the natural record, and so you need to do other lines of evidence, coring, et cetera, or very, very carefully using archaeological evidence.
Thank you, George. And the coring is the essence of the next question, and one of our final questions here today as we wrap up. What about using some sort of deep coring to get to the bottom of the bedrock at one of these springs? Is that a viable thing to kind of a quick attack to get to the bottom?
There are a lot of different ways to take cores, but we have to keep in mind if we're going to core the bottom of Little Salt, for example, we want to do it in such a way that we are not going to use a multi-million-dollar drill system, which could, in fact, drill easily through all of the sediments in the bottom of Little Salt and a couple of hundred feet deeper than that. But that's not what we want to do. We want to very carefully get a biopsy of the sediments in the bottom of Little Salt Spring.
Well, it was mentioned earlier that historical designations and landmark designations and so on in our country are the grassroots thing that comes up from the bottom. And that happens when people are interested enough that they gather together and they fill out forms, or they do research and fill out the forms and document and figure out if these things are significant or not and so on. And it sounds like some of that seems to be in motion, which would be great. One of the aspects of dealing with the buildings that are around Bourne Mineral Springs is that they do have some age on them now, so people do think they fit a criteria for historical. But there are issues with building codes. If you go to fix up an existing building, once you reach certain thresholds, then more and more things have to come up and meet current codes and so on. But sometimes that becomes very impractical on some of these older buildings. Now, with historical designations, sometimes there are ways to do restorations that are responsible and appropriate, but maybe not necessarily meet all the current requirements, that which would oftentimes change the character of the building itself. And in which case, by fixing it up, you'd actually mess it up. So you don't want to do that. So often the Sarasota, these modern buildings were very minimal in structure on purpose because they were to be open and light and open to the environment and all that sort of thing. And we find that at the buildings right at Warren Mineral Springs, which were built for that quadricentennial, essentially as exhibit buildings in 1959. So they've been rehabbed and changed over time. But those functions for exhibits and openness to the surroundings are certainly very valid.
Uzi, did you want to add to that in 30 seconds or less?
Yeah, I think Joe's quite right about those components of historic preservation. But with designation, well, maybe just sign my own age, but I was raised with an ethic of civic pride. And that knowing that a place has a history, that it's got that little emblem saying, yep, it's important. Thanks to the National Registry of Historic Places, or county designation, or city designation, I think does fill people with a sense of pride in their location. It gives them a focus to try to learn history. And so I think it can be a really positive step for this community.
There was someone who indicated that a topic of interest to them is the current condition, the current situation with the spring. And today's session was really designed to talk about the science of the spring, the background of the spring, and hopefully lend us a lot of good information to use to develop a future of the spring. But we really didn't have time today, nor was it the intent to talk about the current situation. Here's a great one. What sort of volunteer activities are in need to support the two sites? And I can tell you that joining us and helping to sponsor this event are both the Warm Mineral and Little Salt Springs Archaeological Society, as well as Friends of Little Salt Springs. Those are both nonprofit organizations composed of volunteers who can activate and utilize volunteers. And they're out there in the back, and they can probably sign you up, sell you a membership, and get you involved so that you can participate as a volunteer. And then as things start to evolve more at Little Salt and Warm Mineral, there may be other opportunities. Ancient Waters' goal isn't to sign everybody up as members of Ancient Waters. Ancient Waters Foundation goal is to support the other organizations in the community in what's going on here. So talk to the representatives of those other organizations.